Which is worse for you, sugar or fat? Coming right up. Hey, this is Dr. Ekberg with Wellness for Life. And if you'd like to truly master health by understanding how the body really works, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you don't miss anything. I saw a video about fat versus sugar on the SciShow channel recently, and they did a great job. It's an awesome channel that does a lot of research on various topics, and then they give you the pros and cons. And this was a very well-researched video. I enjoyed it tremendously. However, I did feel that they left the viewer hanging a little bit. So I'd like to clarify a few points that I feel I know a little bit extra about. So fat has been demonized ever since about 1953. And there was one man more involved than just about anyone else, and his name was Ansel Keys. And he got this idea that fat was a really bad idea. And he brought out something called the 7 Countries Studies. And in this, he looked at countries that ate a lot of fat, and he found a great correlation to how much heart disease there was. However, he failed to mention that there was actually data from 22 countries. So Ansel Keys just cherry-picked the countries that suited his opinion. And when people went back later and looked at all 22 countries, there was no correlation whatsoever. As a matter of fact, 2 countries, namely Switzerland and the Netherlands, had even more fat consumption than one of the countries that was cited in the study, Finland. But Switzerland and Netherlands ate more fat than Finland, and they had 1/3 of the heart disease. So there was a lot of countries involved, but Mr. Keys just picked the ones that suited his purposes. Another study was about cholesterol, and there was always a question whether dietary cholesterol was a factor in blood cholesterol and cholesterol buildup. So one study that they really liked back then was from Russia, where they had fed rabbits a diet high in cholesterol, and then upon dissection later on, they found that the rabbits had indeed cholesterol buildup in their arteries that looked a lot like heart disease. But they've never been able to duplicate that in any other species. And they seem to overlook the fact that rabbits in nature have a zero cholesterol diet. They are herbivores. They eat plants only. So of course, if you feed an herbivore a diet high in cholesterol, it's not the innate species food for them. Any animal that you feed something, including humans, that doesn't belong for that species, you're going to create disease. And if you'd like to know more about those topics, about heart disease and cholesterol, this is a great book, highly recommended. It's called The Great Cholesterol Myth by Johnny Bowden and Steven Sinatra. Another thing about research that we need to be aware of, research is great. I'm all for forwarding science and knowledge, but we have to keep in mind that people who perform the research have a bias. They generally have something that they like to prove. And the other side of the coin is that someone has to pay for the research. And whoever pays for the research isn't interested in finding out things that they don't want to know. Another great book to learn more is called Undoctored by William Davis. He previously wrote Wheat Belly. And he spent over 20 years in the medical field as a cardiologist, so he knows the ins and outs, and he shares a lot of that. And he mentions about research that, for example, in the area of antidepressants, that 37 out of 38 trials that were positive, that produced the results that they wanted to find, were indeed published. But there were also 36 studies that had negative results. They didn't find out. They found the opposite of what they wanted. And 33 out of 36 of those studies were not published. So basically, virtually every time that they find a study that has the results they're looking for, they publish it. And most of the time that they don't find what they're looking for, they don't publish it. So how do we know what the research actually shows? So first of all, researchers have a bias. They have an interest. They have an expectation of what they're going to find. And then in addition to that, they also have to ask themselves, if I find the opposite, if I find negative implications of this, then who's going to pay for my next study? So researchers probably want to be idealistic, but they also have to be realistic and keep their job. So coming back to sugar versus fat, which one is worse? We have to understand a couple of things about sugar. And when people talk about sugar, they usually talk about the white crystallized stuff that you can buy in a package or that is added to processed foods. But sugar or carbohydrates is anything that causes an insulin response. So a slice of toast or a potato or French fries or corn produces about as much of an insulin response as sugar. And it's the insulin response that we don't want. That's the damaging part about the sugar. There are other problems with sugar, being empty calories and depleting minerals and being inflammatory and so forth. But the main thing we want to avoid is the insulin response. So when it comes to sugar, we are mostly concerned about the quantity. So if you keep your carbohydrates low enough, they're not going to mess with you too much. When it comes to fat, however, it's not that sugar is bad and fat is good or vice versa. We also have to look at the quality. So it turns out that when it comes to sugar, it's mostly about quantity. When it comes to fat, it's mostly about quality. So fat has been the preferred fuel for humans for thousands of years, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. It's been the fuel source and the food source that has been the most stable and most readily available across all seasons. That carbohydrates haven't been available to humans throughout the year, but fat typically has, and fat was much easier to store. So fat is the preferred fuel for humans. That's what our physiology is adapted to. But it's very, very important that we look at the quality. For all those tens and hundreds of thousands of years that humans have been eating fat, they have been eating fat exactly in the form that nature provided it. They have been eating animal fats and fish fats and nut fats and so forth. And today, the healthy fats that we can eat has nothing to do with whether it's saturated or unsaturated. It has to do with, has it been altered? So butter is a good fat. Extra virgin olive oil is a good fat. Coconut oil is a good fat. And all natural fats from healthy food, from avocados, from clean nuts, from clean animals. Animals that have been raised in their natural habitat eating what they're supposed to eat. Like a cow is supposed to eat grass. If a cow eats grass, the fat from the cow is healthy. If we feed him grain, the fat from the cow is unhealthy. So it's not that fat is good or bad. It is the quality of the fat. As long as we eat natural fat that humans haven't altered, then we're in good shape. Some of the worst fats, obviously, are all the fats that we have been sold the idea of in the last 50 years. Margarine, vegetable oils that are actually seed oils, because they're so highly processed, so damaged, so heated and bleached and deodorized that there is absolutely no nutrition in there. So is sugar or fat worse? Well, I would have to say that sugar is by far worse, because there is nothing really good about it. There are carbohydrates from vegetables that you can eat almost unlimited, and carbs in their natural form in very low quantity, not moderation according to most people's standards, low carb is what we're looking for. And fat, we can eat just about as much as we like as long as we eat natural fats. And in between there, we want to have a moderate amount of protein as well. So we want to be careful with just looking at research and quoting research for the reasons I mentioned previously. What we really want to do is we want to use common sense. We want to look at historically, how have humans evolved? How does human physiology function? And there's great physiology textbooks. And when we combine the historical research with the physiology textbooks and clinical results, then we have the better package. Then we do research to further our knowledge, but we don't depend on the research. We use it to enhance our understanding. So historical facts, physiology, and clinical results. That's the way that we understand more about how the body really works and what we are supposed to eat as humans. Thanks for watching.